Well, it would certainly be a very elaborate and expensive scale, but that's not what I've got it for. Basically, this is the device I've been telling you about. This is the Calog Loadcell II calibrator and troubleshooting device, which is used for process control networks. Now, as I said, I certainly didn't know much about process control networks, and I've done a fair bit of investigation. I must say, it's really, really interesting stuff. What we're going to do, I'm going to try and give you an overview and an explanation about process control networks, what they are, how they work, the kind of individual devices and measuring equipment that's on them, so that it'll give a good introduction to what this device is and the load cell that you saw that's actually doing the kind of measurement of the weight of the items that are hang from it. I initially, when I was given this device by Comtest to review and have a look at, I thought, okay, it's got an LCD screen, it's got a nice little rough case that it comes in and it measures, so perhaps it'll be interesting. But as I've done more research, it's really, really, really fascinating. As I've discovered, you really need good equipment to work on a process control network to do the calibration. It needs to have fairly high resolution and good accuracy because of the transducers and sensors that are involved on a process control network. So for this video, I'm going to explain how it all works, how it all hangs together, because it's quite a fascinating topic. And then in a follow-up video, we'll actually go through the detail of how this works, what's unique about this particular PCN load cell testing device, and go through its functions and functionality. Now, before we do that, I just want to show you something. You'll have seen a close-up of this load cell, and this thing is like a solid piece of metal with some little bits inside it which does the measurement, which I'll explain a little later. But if you have to try and pull this in your hands, there is no movement whatsoever. It just feels solid. It's rated to measure items up to 1,000 kilograms, and yet I'm weighing things which are weighing less than 10 kilograms. In fact, you saw my wheel was 1 kilogram or less, and down to a tenth of a kilogram. And I'll just show you. If I have that there, 7.3, I'm just going to put a little bit of extra weight on there, and you can see how easy to relax. And I'm just resting, putting my hand on there. So I must say, that's incredible that this load cell, as solid as it is, with just a little bit of input, can measure down to a tenth. That doesn't mean it's very accurate, but certainly its resolution for the range of measurement it's got is incredible. Okay, so here again is the Calog Loadcell calibrator. And the one really cool feature about this, which I'll quickly show you, is that it can source a voltage and a current, a very small accurate voltage and a very small accurate current. And that potentially, of course, gets my interest up, because that can be used as a reference when I'm testing multimeters. Now, it's not designed to do that, but like the voltage standard devices I bought for testing multimeters, their accuracy and what have you, but it's got a fixed 1 milliamp reference. Whereas this has got something which a variable reference which I can change over a range, and it's accurate down to 3 decimal places on a milliamp scale. So for that reason alone, this gets my interest up. So I'll quickly demonstrate that as well. Then the other thing is, what we'll have a look at is this load cell. As you can see, it's very solid construction. It's got like a solid chunk of steel or metal in the middle here, kind of in an S configuration, and inside is the kind of, in essence, the transducer, or there's a resistor network called a Wheatstone bridge, which I'll try and explain when we get down to the notes, which actually does measurement. But I mean, this thing weighs about a kilogram. There's no perceivable movement in it at all. As you can imagine, this has to hold 1,000 kilograms. So it's just amazing to see that it can actually show down to a tenth of a kilogram. But let's quickly have a quick closer look at this connected up to a multimeter. Okay, so what I just want to show you as well, this is the calibration certificate that comes with the Calog load cell 2. And just so you can see, it can obviously measure and source both millivolts and volts. And just to get you give an idea of what it can go down to. So this is on the measurement, and you can see the kind of quoted accuracy is 0.01% of full scale. And on the settings, you can see it's down to 3 decimal places. When they did the calibration, you can see it was literally only one count out right on the third decimal point. And on the millivolts, it's down to 0.005% of full scale. So it really does have good resolution and really good accuracy. So from that point of view, as a source to test multimeters, I think I might quite enjoy one of these. But just to demonstrate it, so I've got it set up to source current at the moment, and you can individually change the digits literally by these key presses over here. So I've literally gone and set it to 1 milliamp. I'm going to set, let me just check. I've put the Fluke 87 Series 5 into its high res mode. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to take it back to zero. Let's just see that it's actually zeroed. No, it's showing, so it's showing something there. So I'm going to delta that out. Now I realize that obviously the Fluke, the accuracy on a current reading is not nearly as accurate as this, the load cell, what it's sourcing. And it's obviously got several counts that it can be out at the least significant digit. So I'm going to delta that out. Then we'll put 1 milliamp in there. And you can soon see, I can source a whole range of small currents to actually test multimeters. If I want a 12 milliamp, there we go, the Fluke's hanging it with it over there. I can then say, well, let's add a 0.1 or another point. I can then go obviously far finer. So, and I can do that with millivolts as well. So from that point of view, I would actually find one of these really handy just as a reference for checking multimeters, because some of the other devices in this range actually do frequency as well. So I'm hoping to get one of those in my hands, because I might end up trying using those as a reference for testing multimeters. But anyway, let's get back to the whole process control networks.
Okay, so if you think of any kind of major production environment where they're kind of producing something, there's probably a process control network and different devices controlling what's happening. If you think of something as simple as a bakery, a huge baking concern, for example, which bakes loaves of bread, they may have a big scale which is sitting there weighing flour, and they'll have a load cell obviously weighing that, and then that signal gets fed back to a process control system, which when it gets to a certain weight stops the chute, closes, activates an actuator to stop the flour coming into the weigh cell basically. You could then have a vessel of water which is being heated up to a certain temperature. There'll be a temperature transducer which is being fed into the process control network. When it hits a certain temperature, it'll obviously stop it. You could then have the tank which feeds that water will have a level dictating whether they rang out of fluids or not. That again is another transducer or element which gets fed back into the process control system. So all those bits and pieces interact to allow a whole process to happen, and that whole thing is kind of called the control process loop or process loop, where there's something happens here which sends a signal to a process control which actuates something else to happen. and that's all over the place. And in some places, it's really critical. If you think of the energy industry, for example, fuel and what have you, they could be piping fuel along a long pipeline. They need to understand the flow rate. There's something in a process which it measures the flow rate and feeds back to other systems. And if they're developing kind of petroleum products, there'll be loads of bits and pieces in those environments, and they're potentially very critical environments. And using devices, this is where these devices become extremely important in making sure they're calibrated correctly, so that you can imagine in a chemicals factory where they're, or a medical environment where they might be mixing medicines, you have to have the right amount of one ingredient, the right amount of another ingredient, and your process has to be calibrated correctly. And then if there's maintenance or problem on in your environment, it could be potentially costing you thousands of dollars, millions of dollars for downtime. And that's where having the right bits of equipment which allow you to troubleshoot that and calibrate right where the problem is becomes critical. But that will kind of cover off when we actually do cover the actual workings of this device and kind of its unique features. So let's have a closer look at the kind of the bones and the elements that make up a process control network. Okay, and I just want to actually bring out this little Arduino board, because in essence, probably that's why I've become quite fascinated with process control networks, is that just like Arduino, the Arduino whole system works with having input and output from this microprocessor. And in essence, this is like a mini process control network. You can have current transducers and voltage transducers and G-force information being fed into your Arduino, some code processing and saying, right, I either need to switch on a warning light, or I'm going to open a door or sound a buzzer. So in essence, it's very similar to what you can do with an Arduino, is set up a whole process control. And this is essence a mini that, in essence. So if we have a look, and have to bear with my little basic sketch trying to give an idea of how this all hangs together. And again, this is an overview. I'm not an expert in this area, and if someone picks up a mistake or has got better information, then certainly please add comments, because this has been a big learning process for me. But let's just say we have a little example where we've got a factory floor, we've got a truck which in essence needs a certain load of sand in a basket to be loaded in before it goes out. And over here we've got a chute which loads poor sand into the basket, and obviously the chute has to be shut off once the basket reaches a certain weight that gets loaded into the truck. Then a rolling door gets opened up so the truck can leave the factory. It's a very simple example. As you can imagine, certain production environments will be hugely complicated with thousands of sensors and what have you. So at the heart of everything, we have the process control system. And in essence, that's like the control processor on an Arduino board. Almost exactly the same. But basically, this receives input from sensors and then sends output to actuators to actually do things. So if we have this example of like the load cell, so here I've got this load cell, and literally all this load cell is these bits obviously pull off. This is in essence the load cell, and as you can see, it's a chunky piece of metal, and behind here, sat inside the metal, and kind of, and I might actually take this off at the second video and show you inside. Inside there is set some resistors, basically in a network called a Wheatstone bridge. But as you can see, it's a very chunky solid piece. And this is potentially, or what would be used, let's say over here on this basket, which is being weighed to be placed in the truck. So how does it work? So basically, to get that
system to work, you'd have what they call an excitation voltage applied to your load cell. Now I'm getting very specific about load cells, but I'll come back to the load cells to explain how this one in particular works. But you'd have a load cell out here being supplied with a voltage from a process transmitter. Then the output from that the transducer or the load cell is read to this transmitter as a millivolt output, and that then needs to get fed back to the process control system so it can decide when it reaches a certain weight it needs to close the slot to stop this from being filled up. Now having a voltage sent over a piece of wire over a long distance is not a good idea because of resistance and what have you. Voltage is more likely to drop off than current. Hence, what this process transmitter does, it does a transformation of the millivolt output, which is giving, in essence, what the weight is of this basket. It gives a corresponding millivolt output, and then it transforms it to a milliamp output. And that is in the range of the 4 to 20 milliamp. And if you've looked at some of the multimeters which I started reviewing, they had this setting where you could set the 4 to 20 milliamp, and I didn't really understand why. And the reason is because in a process control network, you want to specifically see a percentage range of full scale for your transducers between 4 to 20 milliamp. So now we understand why we're working milliamps, because that carries better across your piece of wire. Okay, and again, this is very high level. It gets very technical once you start getting into this. It's a whole science. Why 4 to 20 milliamp? Well, the logic there is that basically that you've got 16 milliamp, which reflects your whole measurement scale. And that could be for a current range of up to thousands of amps. It could be for a weight range from 0 to 1,000 kilograms. It could be pressure. It could be the level of a fluid in a tank. But that is all broken down to that scale of between 4 to 20 milliamp. And the reason they start at 4 is that potentially, let's say you have an issue. If you started, and I think some process control networks can start at 0, but the reason for starting at 4 is that if your load cell here was suddenly out of calibration, and when it came up to 0, it actually went to a negative figure. If you stopped at 0, you perhaps wouldn't see that negative figure. In other words, you go below 4 milliamp, which would give you a negative reading on your scale, which would highlight that you've got a problem. Okay, so that's the logic anyway of why you'd work between 4 to 20 milliamp. So that comes across, and that is read by your process control system, which can then actuate a process actuator. Like for instance, let's say it realizes that the load reaches 800 kilograms, it then gets dropped into the truck, it then actuates a motor to open the door so that the truck can leave. Or at the same time, when it reaches that 800 kilograms, it actuates a process actuator which closes the sluice feeding the basket so that it doesn't fill up anymore. So in our example where we've got the basket this load cell which can read up to 1,000 kilograms. So we've got a range of 0 kilograms to 1,000 kilograms. And as you saw, it can read tenths of a kilogram. So that's your full scale. And you'll see often on equipment that does testing in a process control environment, you have this reading and it translates that 4 to 20 milliamp range, that 16 milliamp, as a percentage of 0 to 100. Because 0 to 100 is an easier figure to deal with when you're calibrating or working with any transducers. So for instance, your 0% is when you're at 0 kilograms, and 100% will equal your 1,000 kilograms. It could easily be a temperature range. Let's say you boiling things and your range is 80 degrees centigrade to 250 degrees centigrade. then that your 80 would be your 0 and your 250 would be your 100. So that represents your scale or your range that you're trying to measure of whatever, and there are just so many things that you can measure which then fall into that range. So for in our example, your scale, I said we can go down to a tenth of a kilogram, in essence we've got 10,000 values which can be measured or read or processed. So across a 16 milliamp range, which you've got in your, which is a fixed range for any process control network, that means you're going to go down to 0.0016, or certainly down to three decimal places, so it's microamps. And that's why, as you saw on this device and on that calibration, they go down to that level and they need to work fairly accurately at that range, because potentially, although in this load cell example, it won't be accurate to a tenth of a kilogram, and I'm not sure what the accuracy of this is. But to still show that and show it as a value on a meter or what have you, that's the range you have to go down to. So hopefully that gives you some idea of what a process network is about and why we have the 4 to 20 milliamp and you use the milliamps from the process transmitter. Then to get down into the actual load cell itself and a basic understanding of load cells, and what I'm going to do in the actual details at the bottom of this video, I'm going to give you some links where you can do some further reading, because it really does become a science. And again, I'll give you a little bit of background after I've explained this. So here I've got a basic representation of this load cell. And this load cell happens to be a four-wire system, although you'll see five wires here. One of them is a shield, but it's got a four-wire system. You do get six-wire systems, and I'll explain a little more about those now. Now, inside this load cell, what you'll have is a network of resistors, and the value of these resistors, and it can obviously differ from different transducers and load cells and what have you. But a common value, and the ones in this one, they, each resistor is set up in a Wheatstone bridge, and they are set at 350 ohm. So the reading across these is 350 ohm. Now again, if you want to understand more about Wheatstone bridges, do some more reading. So we've got something to operate this load cell. We have a 10 volt DC put across it, and that's called an excitation voltage. It's in essence what's required to operate it, but it's not like a normal electronic circuit where you need a certain voltage. This is obviously a set value because it's used for measurement, and so it's this 10 volt DC, and it can be different, is called the excitation voltage, and that's put across the Wheatstone bridge. And if any of these resistances vary slightly, it creates a more amplified output, voltage output in millivolts over here. And that's the four wires. You get the two wires, a positive and a ground, for the 10 volt DC. And this has to be a very, very accurately sourced, regulated excitation voltage. And then you get your output here, which is read in millivolts. And again, that's why this device, these process control bits and pieces, have to be able to read down to have a high resolution, fairly accurate reading, so that they can take that and translate it to the milliamp reading to have a reading out on a meter to actuate a process. So that is what's inside the load cell, and that makes up the four-wire system. Now, there is a whole science to calibrating and a process to how these actually work. So basically, those resistors in here, if there's any slight change in the compression or the pulling on this load cell, it actually changes the characteristic, the resistance characteristic, very slightly, very, very slightly, of these resistances in here, and that's what gives you your output. And it's amazing. As I said, this thing is solid, and you see even just a slight bit of, you know, down to 100 or 200 grams on here has enough influence to provide an output in millivolts over here, which I find quite amazing. Just to give you a bit of background on like calibrating these, and again, it goes into whole science. When you calibrate these, you have to, and this is where you get one of these devices, you have to set it up correctly. And depending on your environment, if you're really in a lab environment, you have to then take into account how this is hanging, the axis it's being used in, whether it's in tension or compression, because you also obviously get compression load cells as well, the temperature. And when it's calibrated, because this is metal, and in essence, if you think of a spring, you pull a spring and it'll come back eventually to its original position. Now this, this isn't a spring obviously because it's really solid, but what they call that, the movement in here is called flexure. It's flexure, it's kind of how much it flexes, obviously you can't see it. But when you put a weight in here, it's obviously going to pull, and there's a little bit of settling time before it gets to the point where you can take a reading. And there's a whole science on when you actually take that reading. Do you wait a second or 5 seconds or 10 seconds for it to settle? And that depends on the kind of environment and process that you're doing, the kind of accuracy that you want. There's also another thing when you're calibrating these, or when you're putting weights on these to test them, you can't just drop them on, because when you drop them, you're going to have a kind of shock, an initial shock. And that can obviously take this out of its range, its correct measurement range, and you're going to have a kind of a hysteresis of when it actually comes back up to what it should be accurately measuring. So there is a whole science about that. I found it really fascinating to read. What I say that in the details is where you'll see more about that. So there certainly is a right and a wrong way to kind of set these up, use them for measurement, to calibrate them, and then obviously when you come to troubleshooting, that's when you need to know what you're doing and have the right kit, because if you don't, potentially you're not going to get the right measurements from these and your whole process can be thrown out, and it could be tens of dollars, hundreds of dollars, millions of dollars, billions of dollars, depending on how critical your process environment is and how an incorrect measurement from a transducer can affect that. So a very fascinating environment. And I say that's why now, I must say, I can really appreciate what these tools are all about and why they need to work well in production environments. So I say it's a whole science, it's just a lot involved. And it's something, I say, which makes the whole Arduino thing quite fascinating, because in essence you're setting up a mini process control network.
Okay, so I hope you found that informative. I hope it gave a little bit of an inkling of what process control networks are, and a little bit about how they operate and what have you. As said, the next video will actually be a review of this device, how it works and what it can do, and particularly this device. As I say, it's manufactured in South Africa, and it's fairly unique in some of the in what it can do. So we'll cover that off and actually do a bit of calibration with this load cell. And this whole area, as I say, you could dedicate, people are the expertise are dedicated just down to doing load cells, because of the science involved in just load cells. And there are hundreds, if not thousands, of other transducers. I say, pressure, temperature, flow control, levels in a tank, and each of them have got their own science on how they operate, how they need to be calibrated, and what have you. So yeah, certainly fascinating. So do look out for the next video if you're keen to see a bit more about this device. I'll also be doing a bit on this with, or something similar to this. I'm hoping to get another one where we can play around with multimeters and check their accuracy and what have you. So thanks very much for watching. Please, if you do enjoy the video series, then do share it with other people. Do rate and give it a thumbs up. As I said, it does progress and help what I'm doing. And I'll catch you again soon for the next video. Thanks very much for watching.